So we were listening to Beethoven's Symphony Number 5, especially famous for that opening little like melody piece, the da 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 da. Beethoven's Fifth is justly admired as one of the greatest musical pieces ever recorded. It is stentorian and powerful and emotional and has that great opening right out of the gate. It oscillates wildly between these loud portions and these quiet portions. This is Romanticism, folks. We are translating once again into a completely new period. And Beethoven is one of the greatest composers of this period. Although this is a period that produced a lot of great composers. In fact, a lot of the composers who we associate with classical music come from this romantic period. So we'll have the opportunity to listen to quite a few of them over the next few lectures as we talk about Goethe and sort of expand our knowledge of what Romanticism is all about. Now, Romanticism as a movement is one of the most major transformative movements because it is occurring at the same time as one of the most major transformative periods historically in the whole business of European history. Romanticism reflects the sort of unrest and violence that the early 19th century tends to embrace. And as we explore Goethe's Faust, I want to sort of like complement that by exploring just the first sort of principles and sort of the outline of what we can come to expect from Romanticism over the couple of weeks that we're going to be studying it. So let's talk a little bit about Goethe. First off, I want to emphasize that Goethe kind of prefigures the Romantic movement. Like, we're going to be reading Goethe's Faust, which was written largely in the 1780s and 1790s. Part one, I believe, was published in the early 19th century, like 1806, I want to say, but I could be wrong if I'm pulling that number out of my butt. Goethe was very representative of a movement known as Sturm und Drang, which is the fancy German terms for storm and stress. And it was very much a reaction against all of this Enlightenment logic and Enlightenment intellectualism that we see at the very end of the Enlightenment and as we see throughout the 18th century. Where the 18th century was very focused on sort of conquering the passions, conquering human weakness, and conquering it with rationality, with logic, with philosophy, where we were going to tame the passions and bring about utopia on Earth in this logically ordered, rational way. Goethe and his contemporaries like Schiller are writing instead directly to the passions. They are learning the same lesson that Rousseau was teaching, but where most of the Enlightenment thinkers carry away Rousseau's social contracts idea, the Sturm und Drang movement is looking specifically at how personal Rousseau's writings often are, especially his writings about teaching, like Emile, especially his own confessions, sort of reflecting on himself. They're seeing this other sort of strain in this whole Enlightenment philosophy, and they're teasing it out, emphasizing it, and it will eventually grow into this whole Romantic movement. No work, though, demonstrates this more effectively than The Sorrows of Young Werther. Goethe wrote this little novella. You can see that the publication date, this is the first edition that I'm picturing here, is in 1774, so this is early even by Sturm und Drang standards. The Sorrows of Young Werther was this fairly haunting little account of a young college student who becomes wildly in love with this lovely woman who is engaged to another man. And this college student explains that he is deeply in love with her and professes his love for her and asks her to leave her fiancé and join him instead. And she refuses because doesn't matter how much he loves her, she's thinking about her future. She's thinking about her economic stability. As we talked about with Don Juan, you know, when you are a woman in this period in European history, your safety very much depends on the financial stability of your husband. She was picking stability over passion. And it's never really clear even if she loves Werther all that much or if it's all just in his head. At any rate, Werther, extremely upset and distraught and beside himself, commits suicide. Earlier he had explained that suicide was the only rational, only sort of fitting end to someone who lived according to their passions and had them frustrated in such a way. And this took off like wildfire. For some reason, like, all these young students in the 18th century were reading this book and then tragically committing suicide. Like, all of these kids were reading this book and killed themselves as a consequence of their own deep felt passions, to the point that it was called Verturism. This idea that, like, these young college students felt vindicated in their destruction of themselves. And this sort of ushers in the Romantic movement. This fairly sort of inauspicious start, all these young men dying, is kind of emblematic of what Romanticism is ultimately going to become. See, the thing about Romanticism is it is very much about these feelings, about passion, about love, and about suffering and tragedy, rather than that, again, very orderly, regimented philosophy that we've seen before. The figure that will come to dominate Romanticism, the figure that's going to sort of, like, be the paradigmatic Romantic figure, is Lord Byron, who was yet another young man who had frequent love affairs and was sort of famous for seducing lots and lots of women, including, like, famous aristocratic women, but who also wrote beautiful poetry and died tragically young. He very much kind of became the poster boy for Romanticism. And there were many other Romantic poets across Europe at this point. Like, focusing on only Byron and Goethe is definitely inappropriate, as important as these two are. But Byron especially sort of not just, like, was a great Romantic poet, but also very much personally exemplified Romantic values. He was a man of passion. He died tragically young. He suffered terribly. He produced great art. Like, that's what the Romantic ideal is supposed to be. We will come back to Byron after we read Goethe's Faust. We will read the first of the cantos of Byron's Don Juan, which is radically different from the other versions of Don Juan we've read so far. So keep that in mind. We, like, put a pin in that, and we'll come back to Byron, but we will drop him for now. What I do want to talk about, like, this is going to be a fairly short little video. I'm not planning to make this a whole lecture. Usually when I teach Goethe's Faust, I like to start the first day with sort of like a primer on what Romantic ideals and what Romantic values actually are, so we know what we're getting into and we sort of know how to position Goethe's Faust as this transitional work between the Enlightenment and the Sturm und Drang response and the eventually mainstream Romantic movement coming down the pike. But I do want to talk about some of the artwork as well. I don't want to get too deep into the history, because we'll talk about how, like, all these revolutions work together later, but we can't talk about Goethe's Faust or the Romantic movement or Romanticism in general without talking about the French Revolution, at least a little bit. So this is Delacroix's Liberty Leading the People, and in addition to this being a great example of Romantic art, which we'll talk about momentarily, it is also one of the classic representations of the French Revolution. You can see Lady Liberty, her breasts bared because Romanticism, carrying the French flag and leading a motley crew of various revolutionaries over the bodies of soldiers and other counter-revolutionaries in their, you know, attack on whatever is going on. And you can see, like, this has very much become sort of like a French national image. Like, as much as, you know, George Washington crossing the Delaware has become one of the greatest paintings in American history, so has this become one of the greatest paintings in Romantic, or in French Romantic history. And both of them are motivated by Romantic values. Like, George Washington crossing the Delaware is equally unrealistic and, like, obviously Romantic. But I want to stress that part of the reason why this emphasis on passion, this emphasis on suffering is going to become so prevalent, why it's going to become so popular, is because with the advent of the French Revolution, a lot of the values of the 18th century are going to get very rapidly and very radically shifted. The French Revolution is difficult to quantify. On the one hand, it represents an effort of a bunch of rational individuals attempting to overcome anachronistic systems with their rationality, much like the American Revolution. All those Jacobins are, for the most part, a bunch of ideologues trying to, you know, convert France from its old aristocratic ways into a new rational one. However, unlike the Americans, they fail. Like, unequivocally, they screw it up, and France is going to be in just complete political and just turmoil for the next 10 to 15 years until Napoleon takes over, at which point they'll take it on the road. It's a nightmare. Like, people are getting killed in the streets, there's no safety, murders are happening left and right, whatever the governing body is at the moment may change in the next, like, week or two. The guys who were primarily responsible for the revolution at one moment will themselves get guillotined the next. Like, it's just chaos. It's incredible violence. It's this churning anger, partially brought about by all of these economic situations that we'll talk about in the future, but also because just there's a lot up in the air. And part of what Europe is recognizing is that that whole rational program of the Enlightenment, that whole we're going to perfect ourselves project of the Enlightenment, in practice, looks really ugly. There's a lot of bloodshed in getting from, you know, time-honored tradition and bloodline monarchy to republics and democracies and whatever else we're trying to put in place. It's an ugly, dirty business. And as a consequence, the Romantics tend to emphasize the ugliness and the dirtiness of this business rather than the end goal of, you know, rationality or utopia or whatever. So you can see here in Liberty Leading the People, the violence is very much on display here. Like, look at how prominently the bodies are featured. They are very corpse-like. Like, they're not pretending that it's not a big deal. Like, this dude is naked from the waist down. Obviously, his body has already been looted. Like, one of his socks is missing. His whatever he was wearing is missing. Like, his pants are missing. The soldiers themselves are all falling over each other, and people are literally climbing over the bodies to get to whatever their goal is. But on the other hand, notice that all of these people come from a wide variety of different backgrounds. You've got this guy with his top hat and his, you know, well-groomed exterior, representing either bourgeois values or possibly even aristocratic values, walking side by side with this guy in his obvious peasant garb, who's just, like, thrown his revolver into his sash because that's what he had to hand. Next to this literal kid holding two pistols, who is obviously a revolutionary as well. What Delacroix is emphasizing here is that this revolution is a revolution of everyone. And while it is messy and gross, and it's obvious that you can't even tell, like, what side some of the people are who died, you know, like Mr. Pantsless here, pretty tough to tell whether he was a soldier or not, it's very much emphasizing that success and revolution and change come at the expense of death, of violence. That's going to be an inextricable part of revolutionary values and of romantic values. Change, but with a cost. Now, that's not all that the Romantic period is interested in. So this is John Constable's The Haywane, which is British Romanticism at some of its best. Notice that this one doesn't emphasize the violence at all. Instead, this has a very different subject matter than we're used to seeing. Almost all of the art movements we've seen so far, with the exception of maybe the restrained Baroque and the sort of Dutch masters who are emphasizing peasant values, for the most part, all of the art has either tended towards let's do depictions of the aristocracy doing aristocracy things, let's do religion, like here is Jesus and Mary and the Renaissance or Mannerism, or on the other hand, let's talk about, like, the old classical subjects and the old myths, like the Oath of the Horatii or the Death of Socrates or the Birth of Venus. Those were important subjects, thus fit for art. This is not that. And even where the Dutch masters tend to emphasize, you know, like peasant people doing peasant things, notice that the peasants aren't even the focus of Constable's The Haywane. Like, the people are just tiny in comparison to the size of this painting. This is a big painting. Like, it obviously was intended to be a major work in its own right. But the people are largely absent. Instead, it's the landscape that is now important. The Romantics are very, very interested in nature. much like, you know, Da Vinci back in the Renaissance was interested in nature, and much like the Renaissance painters were interested in nature, the Romantics not only are interested in it, but they want to portray it for its own sake. Like, nature is a good in itself for the Romantics. And frequently, you know, this is kind of seen as a reaction against the industrialization and urbanization that is becoming common in the early 19th century. All these people flocking to the cities being built up into these industrial, you know, factory and manufacturing towns full of smoke and smog and litter and, you know, grossness. The Romantics yearn for a return to the country. They see nature as being the sort of the obvious antithesis and the obvious remedy to the ills of the modern age. So Constable depicts nature, a peasant farm, otherwise utterly unimportant, otherwise utterly, like, unrepresented in the history of art. Constable wants to emphasize it. He is saying, you know, a tree, this landscape, the fields in spring, this dog barking at the side of the mud that they're wandering through, this random peasant's house, this is fit for art. It is every bit as important and meaningful as the death of Socrates, as the oath of the Horatii, as, you know, God and Adam on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel, as the Lord's Supper. As any of the things that we have, you know, typically painted, as any picture of kings and conquerors. Peasants, too, are important. This pastoral scene is what a lot of the Romantics aspire to. And notice, too, the way that the figures are represented here. I emphasized in the Rococo especially that we're moving away from this sort of detail-oriented realism. The Romantics take it another step away. You can see that, again, the trees are not represented as these sort of, like, obvious figures. The detail work of the branches and the leaves isn't focused on. It's blurry. It's ambiguous. It's a little vague. And the Romantics are okay with that. In fact, Constable and others will emphasize that they want the painting to look like a painting. They want to emphasize that this is a subjective experience, that artwork is created from the subjective perspective. Again, this emphasis on this rustic peasant rural life is rendered as Constable's own attitude. Like, you'll remember all those Renaissance artists were very quick to sort of paint their works as though they were distant, as though there was no artist and they were just sort of like capturing this eternal moment. And many of the artists since have sort of copied that paradigm. Like, go ahead and add chiaroscuro, go ahead and add different perspectives. The only painting that we've really seen that did in fact emphasize the business of painting itself was Velázquez's Las Meninas, and that one was way out there for its time. Here, instead, Constable is trying to convey that this is from a person's perspective, this is rendered as their opinion, as their attitude, and this is a good thing. We should value personal experience. We should value individual expression as much as these sort of eternal verifiable truths. And this, again, flies in the face of all that modern Enlightenment thinking, all of these eternal truths, all of these objective values. Now the subjective is what the Romantics want to display. Individual personal feelings are every bit as important to the Romantics as, you know, the eternal truths and the eternal, you know, systems of religion or philosophy were to the Enlightenment. And you can also see this in the way that the Romantics understand nature. So this is Caspar David Friedrich's Monk by the Sea, and I think this has very much become, like, my favorite work of Romantic art. Like, I actually have a copy, a print of this, hanging in my office at this point. I have fallen in love with this painting since I've started teaching it. And notice, here we have a religious work. It is a painting of a monk specifically. But notice, again, just like we saw with Constable, the person, the actual humanity of it, is reduced to this tiny little figure against this huge landscape. Like the rocky cliff by the sea, the huge sea itself, and then, like, literally 3/4 of the painting is devoted to sky. It's just clouds. It's impressions of clouds. Again, it's not terribly realistic. You can't see, like, where the clouds end and where the sea begins in some cases. It's dark, and it's fuzzy, and it's messy. You can see the individual brush strokes. You can see that it, you know, isn't delineated clearly. And what I want to emphasize, and what Caspar David Friedrich is trying to emphasize here, is that this is how Friedrich sees God. This monk by the sea, the emphasis here is that human beings and human religiosity is dwarfed by the enormity that is the world around us. This is how the Romantics view nature oftentimes, and this is why the Romantics emphasize nature. They are trying to get back to the like smallness of human endeavor. And you will see over and over and over again this emphasis by Romantic artists to sort of depict religion as though it can be found most obviously in nature. Now, this is a huge move away from what we've seen before. Like, nature is frequently portrayed as either the backdrop or sort of, you know, verisimilitude for these paintings. It is very rarely the subject itself. And yet the Romantics insist upon this. And again, part of that is probably because they're reacting to the industrial age, but part of it, too, is because nature represents something still untamed. Up until now, nature has been largely hostile to human beings. Like, if you are a peasant living on the outskirts of some small town, itself on the outskirts of some major town, you probably have to worry a lot about what nature is doing at any given moment. Your planting cycles will be affected by what the weather is doing, your crops will be endangered by the wildlife in the area, and thus you have to, like, constantly battle against them to keep your food and your livelihood safe. If you wander too far afield, you are actually in danger of being, like, eaten by wolves or other predators. Nature hasn't been conquered. Now, here at the beginning of the 19th century, nature is very much beaten. There are steam locomotives, and there are, you know, the telegraph will be invented in the near future, and people can travel over long distances safely without worrying about being attacked by animals or predators or bandits. Nature has become something of a luxury. And these Romantic artists are sort of hearkening back to a world where nature was still in charge, where nature did still call the shots, where nature was a constant reminder of how powerless human beings were. The Romantics want to get back to that powerlessness. The Enlightenment was all about human ingenuity, all very proud of human accomplishment, all very much emphasizing that humans could conquer all of their weaknesses, conquer nature, conquer human failing and sin, conquer religion even. The Romantics are reminding us that God is bigger than this. And that's what Friedrich is ultimately depicting here. The monk came to the sea to worship. All this cloud, all the sky, all the cliff, all the sea, that is God that Friedrich is trying to depict. God is so great that he built a world so unfathomably large that human endeavor looks like this tiny little speck by contrast. As much as, you know, Romanticism is born out of the French Revolution, as much as Romanticism is born out of this, you know, period of enlightenment, it is very much trying to reemphasize that humans are a small part of whatever is going on in the universe. We only see a tiny portion of what's happening, and all of our accomplishments ultimately measure up to very little in the history of the world, of the universe. But you can also see this in the way that the Romantics typically portray nature. So here is Snowstorm, Hannibal and his army crossing the Alps by J.M.W. Turner. And Turner is another of my favorite Romantic artists. You will see a lot of Turners hanging around on my PowerPoint presentations and elsewhere. Notice here, again, we have that same sort of de-emphasis of human activity. Like, you can see the humans down here on the, like, coming up the mountain. You can see them on their horses, and it's kind of hard to make them out because they are so small, because, again, the brushwork is sort of rough, intentionally so. Again, like, three-quarters of the canvas is dedicated to the sky, specifically all of these awful storm clouds that are, like, rearing up against the mountains and striking down on the humans beneath them. This is what Turner wants to emphasize. Not just that nature is overwhelming, that it is so much more big and powerful than anything that humans have accomplished, but also that it is violent, that it is untamed. Just as the Romantics have been emphasizing, you know, personal suffering and sort of like how much, you know, great accomplishments can only be achieved through blood and turmoil, combine that with Romantics' love for nature, and you get Turner and his depictions of this, these sort of violent storms and nature sort of rearing its ugly head and smiting human beings where they stand. Just as the Romantics de-emphasize human accomplishment, they are also quick to emphasize that nature can turn on them in an instant. So, you know, this depiction, this would be normally a pretty good subject for art. Like, Hannibal is a classic Roman general. The, you know, achievement of Hannibal crossing the Alps is typically, you know, of major importance to the history of Europe. Like, this is a major formative moment for Rome. And yet, where, you know, the Romantics or the Baroque would probably emphasize Hannibal's accomplishment, like show all of his elephants and all of his people in bright colors and bright array, like fighting their way through the Alps, triumphing over the elements. Here, Turner is depicting the elements beating the living shit out of them. They are beaten back. They are destroyed by this. It is, every inch is a battle, to get up these mountains. And so you see the people where you can see them, like, lying across their carts or huddled against the rocks for protection. These are not conquerors. These are people barely surviving this endeavor. Accomplishment can only come through this suffering, through this battle. And notice, too, that this frequently is conflated with these ideas of tragedy and catastrophe. So let's look, as a sort of way of contrasting this, let's look at the neoclassical Death of Murat by David in 1793, and on the right, the Execution of the 3rd of May by Goya. Both of these are depictions of violence, but one is very neoclassical and the other is very romantic. So David's Death of Murat, you can see Murat is lying in the bathtub. This is, of course, a justly famous painting. It depicts one of the major leaders of the French Revolution assassinated by his servant in his bathtub as he's writing a letter. But notice, David very much de-emphasizes the violence of the scene. Instead, Murat looks peaceful, like he's relaxed. His body is a little bit contorted, but he's right in the middle of the letter. You can see, like, the quill is still in his hand. You can see the knife. You can see the wound. You can see the blood coming from the wound, but it's all very tame. Like, there's only a couple of spots of blood, even though it's a white cloth that he's lying on. The knife itself has maybe a little bit of blood on the edge, but not a whole lot. Even the wound, like, it's very neat and tidy. If anything, the most graphic depiction here is the little bit of glimpse you get of the bath water, which is discolored red, and it's obvious that he's, you know, lying in a bath of his own blood. But notice, you know, we who are used to now CSI and all of our grotesquery on television would know that, like, anyone whose body gets left in a bathtub for any length of time is going to, like, bloat and get ugly and gross. Instead, Murat is depicted as peaceful. David is de-emphasizing the violence of the moment. It's tragic, but it's not horrifying. Goya, on the other hand, is all about the horror in this situation. You can see, like, all of the troops are lined up faceless, totally depersonalized, dehumanized even by Goya. The mourners themselves are also faceless. Like, the one guy is covering his face in his hands. The other faces are rendered only partially, like very impressionistically. Instead, the only faces that are on display are the faces of those about to be shot, the suffering, like this guy with his hands in the air, or the faces of the dead, the corpses. And notice how this is not at all neat and tidy. The corpses are lying in this huge pool of blood. It is messy and disturbing and grotesque. And what's more, Goya is emphasizing that it's all about to happen again. There's something pointless about this violence here. There is something completely senseless about it. Like, as much as I emphasize that the Romantics are all about the suffering, they do also recognize that that suffering is frequently senseless, pointless, just mean and dumb. As much as, you know, I emphasize with Delacroix that, like, you only overcome adversity through violence, through suffering. At the same time, some of that adversity and suffering is just thrust upon you, and there's nothing you can do about it. Not even survive, in the case of these people lined up, getting ready to be executed. Nature and the world and human nature are all just dumb brute forces to the Romantics. There is nobility in overcoming them, but more often than not, they overcome you. And that's not out of keeping with the Romantic understanding of the world. For the Romantics, it's not accomplishment through suffering that needs to be acknowledged. It is suffering for accomplishment. Suffering itself is what the Romantics want to emphasize. It is a good in its own right. It is worthwhile in its own right. Even if you do not accomplish the goal that you set out to do, even if you do not overthrow the corrupt regime, even if you do not successfully, you know, cross the Alps, as long as you suffered, as long as you fought for it, that in itself is worthwhile for the Romantics. Now, this is completely different from what we've seen before. Most of the artists that we've seen, they are depicting suffering for a cause, and the cause is what's emphasized. The suffering is de-emphasized. Marat died for a cause. You can see the work that he's doing, even in his bathtub, as he's stabbed. It is his work that is emphasized by David, not the suffering. By contrast, Goya emphasizes the suffering, not the accomplishment, not the deed. The two are very different. Now, I want to emphasize this because we're also going to see a lot of it in Goethe. Goethe, too, is going to see suffering for its own sake to be a virtue. And Faust will be, you know, Goethe's Faust will be sort of the poster boy for this ideal. Faust will ultimately declare that, like, even God will declare of Faust that his defining characteristic is his striving, his unwillingness to give up, his willing to just suffer through whatever life throws at him, and his acknowledgement that as long as he keeps suffering, as long as he never gives up, it doesn't matter what stupid, idiotic crap he's getting involved in, it is still worthwhile. That is very in tune with the Romantics. They very much see suffering itself as being the sort of, like, primary way that humans engage with the world and the primary virtue that humans express. So here we come to the sort of way that this ultimately comes together. This is The Raft of the Medusa by Theodore Géricault in 1818, and this painting comes with a bit of a story. The story is that there was this ship, the Medusa, carrying immigrants and settlers across the Atlantic Ocean. They didn't get too far out of European ports, though, before the ship sprung a leak and began to sink. And the captain, thinking this was, realizing that he, you know, couldn't save everyone, there were too many passengers, the boat was overloaded and there weren't enough lifeboats, he and his crew quietly escorted themselves into a rowboat, into some of the longboats, and took off. They built a small raft out of the boards of the boat, like, in order to try and save as many people as possible, but then they ducked out. Like, no civilians got into the longshore boats, like, just the crew and the captain took off, leaving them to fend for themselves. Now, as it happened, the raft survived. People, you know, several people survived this whole shipwreck, floated on the raft back to Europe, and were sort of discovered and rescued. But this was a horrible nightmare to, like, French publicity at this time. The people who were stranded on the raft were forced to do some absolutely horrific things. Many reports say that they resorted to cannibalism. The raft was too small, and, like, there wasn't even enough space for people to, like, stand upright. It was, of course, very leaky and very shabby and not designed to succeed at all. And Géricault, you'll notice, emphasizes all of this. In our painting, we can see the bodies, the corpses strewn about over the Medusa as people have been, like, fighting them to get their place. And you can see one is even already engaged in cannibalism, as early in the process as this may be. You can see there are people sort of climbing over each other to sort of signal, to try and get themselves rescued. But the whole thing is just this writhing mass of flesh and, like, death and violence. Again, with the backdrop of nature as this dangerous force, the waves threatening to overwhelm this tiny little raft. It's a mess. And notice that the Romantics are very much emphasizing, again, this human suffering, this human pain and awfulness, this senselessness of the world and of nature sort of threatening to crush it and overcome it. But here we see why. Gary Coe is definitely drawing attention to the complete incompetence of, on the one hand, the captain and the crew of the ship who abandoned these people to die in this horrific way. On the other hand, he is also emphasizing the horrific mismanagement of the nation's resources by the French king and country. He is emphasizing that this is a national horror, a national disgrace, and we should be ashamed of ourselves for contributing to it. The wealth of all of these upper-class nobles and leaders and soldiers exists because all of these people suffer and die pointlessly. And that's not acceptable anymore. This is very much intended as a political statement. And many of the Romantics are very engaged in the politics of the day. They are very angry about the injustices that they see on a regular basis. This is a time of great change, and Gary Coe is on the side of the revolutionaries. They want a new world. The old one will not do. This is what the old world has produced. All of those aristocratic excesses that we saw in the Rococo and that were rejected in the neoclassicists is now placed front and center, not as something enduring and valuable and sexual and frivolous, but as something with very real serious consequences. People are suffering and dying for money. People are suffering and dying out of negligence. People are suffering and dying because of oversights by people who should do their jobs better, who should be responsible, be held accountable for what they are doing. And Gary Coe is calling for that, and so are the Romantics. They see all human experience as valuable, all human suffering as worthwhile, and therefore they do not privilege the rich over the poor. If anything, they privilege the poor over the rich. They see the poor as striving constantly, suffering constantly, and therefore being the new heroes, as opposed to all of these indulgent nobles who have been living in their fancy houses and homes, who have been playing games with money and playing games with sex. Those people can go screw themselves. Now is the time to respond to the cry of the peasant, in short, to try and sympathize with the people who have been dunked on for their entire lives. Now, the philosopher who most represents all of this thinking, the guy who sort of is himself a Romantic and very much also spurs Romanticism on, as we'll discuss later, is Hegel. Hegel is the quintessentially Romantic philosopher, and he, as, you know, would befit this moment of great revolution and change, radically changes philosophy. Where Rousseau and the philosophes and then Kant after them were very much emphasizing, again, this cult of reason, this sort of accomplishment of rationality bringing about a utopian age, Hegel kind of does something similar. He also is insisting on a utopian age. He is also, like Kant, insisting that it is inevitable. But where Kant emphasized that it would be through, you know, subjugation of the passions, through the triumph of rationality, Hegel's describing something else. His phenomenological approach prioritizes history and the conflicts in history especially as a way of coming to that inevitable utopian vision. He sees suffering and sort of confusion as bringing about wisdom and intelligence. In the Phenomenology of Spirit, he tracks what he calls the spirit, Geist, this sort of humanity's spirit, this collective spirit of human endeavor, as it struggles to understand both itself and its world. For Hegel, that struggle is often violent. Humanity's struggle against nature, humanity's struggle against its own nature, humanity's struggle against itself, humanity's struggle against the humans that it perceives to be opposite, all of this is somehow bringing us to the conclusion of history. So Hegel is basically suggesting that history is about to end. We are in the last age, but we are not going to get it through, you know, intellectual conquest. We're going to get it through suffering. We're going to get it through conflict. And a lot of thinkers are going to run with this idea. A lot of thinkers are going to adopt this because it is very romantic. It both reflects the romantic ideals and sort of justifies, spurs them on. So we will see a lot of thinkers, after he publishes The Phenomenology of Spirit in the early 19th century, sort of expand on these ideas, develop these ideas, and grow them into something new, most notably with Karl Marx. But we will talk about that later. So with that in mind, that is the end of the first little mini lecture here, and we can talk about Goethe. So if you were following along at home or working on it for class, make sure to jump over to the podcast lecture, and we'll talk about the first chunk of Goethe's Faust Part 1.